In 1991, I got my first phone call from Jones. Then another, and another. Every week since, without fail, I've had these phone calls with Jones. Not sure what to expect or what the topic will be, or even why I pick up. All I know for sure is every week, I get another phone call from Jones.
Hey, did you get your Powerball ticket?
No, my old lady's like, make sure you get a lottery ticket on the way home.
Yeah.
Which I do not do. So I'm like, nah, I don't know, man.
We had a thing at work where everybody gives $5 and is buying in. I just do it for the office fun of it, but it's so funny. Like, do you know how infinitesimal we've just increased our odds?
Well, what are you going to do with the money, man? Go to Australia? Say it.
No, you know what, though? Every once in a while I go to a lottery ticket, and I just like it for the buzz of, like, the dreaming about it. You know what I mean? Like, God, that would be awesome. So we did this, I don't know, like, rough math on it. Let's say my share out of the work office pool thing would be, like, $60 million or $70 million. It'd be, oh, that would be
after
so
taxes, cool. You're looking at, you know, a cool $25.
I'd take it. I'm not going to worry about that. So let's even say $25 million. First of all, I would put in my notice at work.
You would?
Yes, I would start.
Terrible.
I would put in my notice at work. Everybody, that's even a mystery. Everybody at work was talking about how if the office wins it, they're just going to close up shop.
Yeah, nice.
But he's just going to leave. But yeah, I would. I'd leave work, I'd buy a home, I'd buy a place out kind of in the Wrigleyville area, I'd buy a Porsche, and then after that, I would just, I don't really know, but I would just kind of do whatever I want.
But like a nine-year-old boy, you have it figured out that you'd buy a mansion and a car.
Yeah, no, I haven't got, which it, actually, that may be just to tell it, maybe you shouldn't go beyond the nine-year-old desire. That's your true desire. You got the nice house, the nice car. I think what I would like to do, I would like to build, like kind of do like almost a Joe Rogan or Adam Carolla thing and build your own kind of podcast studio.
Okay. All right.
I would do that. I would definitely do that.
But, again, you don't need $60 million to do that.
No,
you don't. Started with, you know, a grand.
Right, but I don't have like, I can just build out whatever I want. I don't have to do piecemeal. I can just do, like, radio fantasy camp and just build that bitch out the nth degree. I think it'd be
pretty... Yeah, I mean, it sounds pathetic, but this is why I don't even buy a ticket, because I don't even think I would change anything, really.
Yeah, but why is that pathetic, though? If, like, you got your dream house...
Pathetic is a bad choice of words. I don't think it sounds believable, but I think that should probably be the litmus test for people for their job or for their career or whatever, profession and whatever. If you won the lottery, would you quit doing it? And if that's the case, then why are you waiting until you win the lottery?
Well,
life is too damn short. Quit right away.
Right, but it's not viable for me to then go, I am now living on a podcast. I mean, it's even viable to go right now and say...
Well, or at least find something that you wouldn't quit the minute you had the chance to. You sound like some broad from Boston.
Yeah, but I certainly, you know, I have tried to do those things. You know, I have tried to do those things, and they haven't caught on. Like
that makes money, but also gives you catharsis.
Right, and at times I do enjoy what I do, but all of a sudden... If I had $60 million and I could do exactly what I wanted to do, I would do that.
Yeah. So,
I mean, it's not realistic to say, I mean, you know it as much as anybody. It's not realistic to go, man, I would love to do like my own little talk show thing. And I'm just going to go down there. I'm just going to knock on WGN doors. Like, that's just not, you just can't up and do that.
Well, yeah, I honestly do. When they do those shows, now obviously the whole premise of the show is lottery equals misery, so they're not going to find the people who have been ecstatic. They're going to find, like, the lowest of the low. But there does seem to be some validity to the preponderance of lottery winners who end up in anguish, honestly. And I've even heard some, like, man, winning that money was the worst thing that ever happened to me.
Because
money just magnifies whoever you are. Money and sickness magnify your true personality.
Well, okay, money and sickness magnify your true personality. So when my parents passed away and I immediately didn't have to work, like, what did I do? I wrote books. I put together a television show. Like, that's the kind of stuff I did. Like, I love putting that stuff together. That's more fun, and I'm actually one of the few people that can say, creating a television show is actually more fun than having it. And it is true. Like, creating that stuff is more fun than actually going, oh, there I am on TV.
It's the thrill of the chase. It's pursuing the girl is much better than actually having the girlfriend sometimes.
Yeah, there's large elements of that that are true. So I think that's why if you gave me $60 million, I'd go out the material things I'd get, nice home, nice car, and then after that it would be like, great, I can get my books edited. I can go balls out self-publishing that stuff. I can do my own podcast, and Mike can come over and his studio spot would be right there. Like, I could do that stuff.
If you win the lottery, I can still come over?
Yeah.
Thanks, man. I think that's part of the problem with winning the lottery.
What?
All of a sudden, everyone's coming at you with an open hand.
Well, I guess I'd have to try to navigate that, but in terms of my own enjoyment, I'd be happy doing that. Because that's what I would be. I would leave work now if I had a chance to write or do talk radio or a viable podcast show. If I could do that, I would totally do that. I wouldn't shop anywhere like above Banana Republic. I'd still go down to Trader Joe's. You know, I don't think I'd be going crazy with like buying a $70,000 crotch rocket motorcycle or.
Oh, you would totally. Well, you're gonna buy a $70,000 car at least.
No, I'd buy like I'd buy like a $200,000 car, but I would just buy one. I just buy one. I buy a Porsche 911 twin turbo, and then
God,
I
hope you win the lottery because I cannot wait to play this back and be like, "Look at what a pimp you've turned out to be! Look at all these cars! Look at you!"
No, because here's my thing though. I wouldn't do that because I've really now, in the last couple years, in kind of my ups and downs, I've really come to the conclusion that money isn't happiness. And I know people who have a ton of money, and they will tell you flat out, the best way I've heard it put to me, money does not give you happiness. It gives you options, but it doesn't give you happiness. It's from someone who has a ton of it. And I totally see how that would work. And my own philosophy is, it's not masculine for a man to have more than one, maybe two really nice things. Like, then it's when you get, like, you're two up your own ass. If you're going out there, for example, let's say your business picks up in the next year. You're killing it. And then you decide, I don't want to buy a Harley Davidson. That's cool. A man should be able to, if he has the means, buy a Harley Davidson. Or buy a Porsche. Or buy a fishing boat. Whatever that thing is. But all of a sudden, if it's like, no, I don't even know how to sail a boat, or I don't even have a boating license, but I'm going to go out and get a cigarette boat and go flying up and down Lake Michigan. I'm going to buy four Lamborghinis. I'm going to buy a place in the Hamptons. And you go crazy with that stuff. Like, I genuinely think that's not masculine.
Wow. You're questioning the masculinity of people who spend opulently.
Because a real man doesn't have to be like that show. You know, you can still go to, you know, you can go to Banana Republic and buy nice clothes. You can buy really nice clothes there. But you don't have to go to like the little boutiques where a cardigan sweater is $575.
Okay, so it's the showiness, it's the braggadocio-ness. Is that a word? Braggadocio-ness?
It is now.
Whatever. It's the public showiness of one's material items that you feel is not a masculine trait. Admirable trait. Maybe not masculine.
I would say masculine, believe it or not. I know that sounds kind of weird, but it's like, okay, it's like an effeminate, like, kind of girlish thing to have a whole closet full of shoes. But for whatever reason, women do seem to need that. They genuinely seem to need that. If you're that guy, and I dress well, but if you're that guy that, like, just, even if you, I don't even know if I need it, but I need it, so I know I have it. Like, I think you're veering over into woman shoe world. Like, it's somehow masculine. Like, if you went over to, let's say, some guy's house, you know, you're going over to Bobby Pemberton's house, and you're like, ah, Bob, you have a nice house, you know, blah, 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 you've done well for yourself. And he goes, hey, yeah, dude, come out to my garage. Check out my 1963 Porsche 911 that I refurbished. That's kind of cool that you have, like, that one thing. You have some maybe level of expertise on it or knowledge or passion about it. But if everything is, like, I work with a guy, or I'm sorry, I play hockey with a guy who, he's a great guy, does very well for himself. But, like, he has a $15,000 watch. And one of my friends who's on the hockey team with me would tell me, dude, do you know that his watch requires $400 of maintenance every year? You know what I mean? Like, now, if you always wanted that one watch and you got it, that's cool. That's fine. But if you're doing that and you have a whole rack of those watches, and then you also have to have the whole fleet.
Well, how in the world did anyone find out that it's a $15,000 watch? He told someone, clearly.
Yes.
So he is the D-bag walking around telling people that.
Unless, and I had been to his house, he has a beautiful house, but he was very cool about how nice his house is. So it's probably a bad example to use that, because he's not really showy outside of it. Like, when we go on these hockey trips, he's, like, buying drinks for everybody, but, like, really gracious about it. Like, he's very giving with his money. But when you have to have a fleet, look at my whole rack of, like, here's my collection of 10 $15,000 watches, and let's go out and look at my vintage Corvette collection where there's 15 of them all lined up. I keep using the number 15, but, you know, that to me is, like, almost a feminine kind of, I'm pretty, right? I'm pretty. That's the way I take it when a guy does it. But, like, if a guy takes you downstairs, like, dude, check out the basement that I built. I put $45,000 into this bar. I did this. And it's like, okay, fine. You had that one thing that you went balls out.
Right.
I get that. But, like, if your whole world has to be like, dude, come here, try this tequila. Dude, this is $2,800 tequila. Every element of your life is $2,800 tequila. I take that as it's effeminate. Even if you're the most masculine dude and you're totally straight, I'm not even questioning sexuality. But it's just like, dude, it's kind of girlish that you're so, like...
Right. Yeah, that would make, you know, I always like to get back to humans as animals, and I always try to figure out, okay, well, what would be the base emotion for this, or what would be the animalistic reason for that trait? And so, yeah, women were, you know, as animals, were supposed to, this is going to give me the big trouble, it's supposed to be attracting the mate, right? And so men weren't supposed to have to, although they, you know, rams are battering each other for the affection of the woman, and, you know, bears are fighting each other, so men are showing off to some degree, or males in the animal world as well. So to say that males shouldn't show off, I don't know, man. I don't know if you're on base here.
Well, but what I'm saying is, like, you can live a healthy lifestyle. And healthy, I mean financially healthy, where you have a $500,000 house. People have to have a place to live, whether it's an apartment, a condo, a townhouse, a house, whatever. So you have a nice $500,000 house, $1 million house, $2 million house. You just had the money, write the check, and you moved in, and you put beds in there, and you put couches in there. Everybody has to do that. But what I'm talking about is when you go beyond, and now you have to accessorize every element of your life. I'm saying, you give me $60 million, and I wouldn't do that. Like, even if you came into my house, you're like, okay, Jones, oh, wow, God, he really won the $60 million. We were talking about that. I can't believe it happened. And you're walking around my house, like, God, he did. He bought a nice house in Louisville. This is great. Oh, and there's his 911 out in the driveway. He said he was going to do that. Like, even if it's like, oh, wow, and look at this super cool, like, podcasting studio he built for himself. But, like, if you're doing something with the stuff and it's, like, your passion, like, I can claim to go with that. But when you were saying, like, I would have, like, a fleet of 6 cars, and I think that's kind of...
Dude, yeah. I mean, your diamond-encrusted shillelagh shoehorn is going to be a little over the top, I think.
Right, and I'm telling you, I will avoid all of that. So what would you do with $60
million? Yeah, well, that's the thing. That's why I never buy the ticket, because I don't... I don't really dream those dreams for some reason. So I just skip it entirely and go, I don't even need the ticket. It sounds so ridiculous, but I don't know why. I can't even bring myself to go do it, even when my old lady's telling me to.
Right, right.
So I don't know. I don't want to partake at all.
There's not one luxury item you would buy, or you wouldn't be like, you know what, that does sound cool. I'd build myself a podcast studio. Or I would...
Yeah, well, that's the only thing that I've always thought would be cool is to have a lake house to bring my kids. But even then I go like, yeah, and everybody I know that has one is always bummed out because they got to go work at their house, their second house every weekend.
I'd never do that.
Drag to drive there or whatever. So,
yeah.
I don't know, man. I don't really... sit around thinking about that stuff.
I would never want the second house. Second house sounds like a nightmare. It's just nothing I want.
As long as someone is keeping it up for you, like, so the people that are always complaining, it's like, well, okay, well, but what if you didn't have to do the maintenance on it or whatever? You literally just rolled up, parked in the driveway, ran out to the back, got in the boat, and went fishing or skiing or whatever.
Right.
So it seems like, oh, okay, get that shit when you can actually afford to, like, have a crew come by and take care of it for you or whatever, you know?
Right, right. But there's not like, like, what would you, I mean, would you still be, do you like doing what you're doing now in spite of the
money? Yeah, I would totally do it. In fact, I would probably take the money and hire some salespeople on a base.
Now, really, I mean, you really like the, and I'm not questioning it, but it's funny, like, you like the idea enough that you would really just keep
doing it? Sure. Of course.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Because I'm still always, I guess, more of that mind. To me, what you're trying to do with the whole medical website thing is such an adult idea where I'm thinking, like, I would build my own studio and host my own talk show. It's still kind of going back to that, like, idea when we were undergrads, and it was like, dude, let's do talk shows and that'd be awesome. And it just seems like this young thing, which doesn't make it your idea any less, but it's kind of weird. It's like, wow, it still seems like a pretty adult idea that you have. And then if you had play money and didn't have to worry about it,
again, the idea is to have a media, you know, team, facility, infrastructure, resources, et cetera, right now that is churning out health-related media, but that doesn't have to be the only vertical or subject matter or topicality that we're addressing. So, yes, if I had an influx of $60 million, could I branch faster into other verticals? Of course. But, honestly, dude, I mean, I'm doing it also for a reason. The woman in my neighborhood has got lung cancer, dude. She got her diagnosis like days ago, and she's being rushed into surgery. People don't even have time to investigate anything. They don't know where to turn, and they don't even think about turning anywhere. They don't even know there's anywhere to turn. All they're being told is, you got cancer. We got to cut that out. It's like, really? Really? So that's part of my mission here, is to like make it so like, all right, well, you can still go rushing under the knife if you want, but don't ever see me at the block party or at a family party or wherever, and don't think that I don't know that there's other things you could be trying.
Right.
I just think it's ridiculous, and I think it's high time that somebody does something about it. And since I found some people to underwrite it, I think it would be stupid to not go forward. If I had no sales, no money generated, nothing built out, nothing, and I had $60 million, would I reconsider? Possibly, but I've already come far enough. Why stop now?
We
could still do, like, you know, bullshit, you know, jokey stuff on a different channel.
Even though you're doing the health thing. What would you do then if you didn't have the health thing? I want you to think about this stuff.
No, that's the thing. I chose this. I didn't have anything. Nobody pushed me in this direction, and I chose it. So I've already kind of made my choice. Nobody paid me $60 million to do this. Nobody's paying me anything to do it. Today, nobody paid me to go there. So yeah. I'm already living my lottery dream.
Well, then you are truly the richest among us.
Well, no, but I mean, and obviously I see an upside financially, or I wouldn't be doing it, but I mean, I literally can do anything I want right now. I'm not going to monster.com looking for, you know, some job selling windows or some job driving a truck or whatever. I chose this, and I said, all right, I'll make money doing this. But I had to create the way to make money doing it. So if I can do this, I could probably figure out another way to make money doing something else. That's why I'm saying, ultimately, why wait to win the lottery?
See, I haven't figured out how to blow up a podcast or to get a talk show or to launch a book yet, so I'm still picking at it.
Well, I think we're having a breakthrough of sorts.
We are having a breakthrough of sorts, actually.
I feel a lot better. I, you know, when you were mentioning the showy off thing, the showing off, and then is it masculine? I wasn't going to bring it up, but it did pop into my mind. Everyone's fawning all over this kind of marketing piece, posing as a family viral Christmas card video. Have you seen this?
Is this what they're in the driveway or something? Are they dressed all goofy and?
Yeah, it's like a family in their Christmas jammies with a customized song to whatever, Welcome to Miami, Will Smith.
Right. Let me see if I can pull it up. I mean, I saw the little clip of it, but I didn't click inside of it. Let's see here.
It's funny because as you were mentioning that, I was thinking of this family where they kind of pretend at the end, like, oh, we did this for a business. But it's like, no, you guys always are bragging like this. It's full of bragging, this whole video. And, like, most people seem to be taking it very well. People are like, this family rocks. And it's like, no, this family is the douchiest bunch of douchebags who have ever lived in all of douchebagsville. How could you like these people? You know, if they weren't doing this particular Christmas card did go viral, but they've been doing this shit for 20 years and boring the hell out of their neighbors, family, friends, and associates with all of their fabulous accomplishments. This weak, feeble business attribution at the end, I'm not buying at all. I think that was just their excuse to be like, we don't want to be totally douchebags, so we'll pretend that this was part of our business. Okay.
Right. Oh, Jimmy's, Xmas Jimmy's hug is a huge hit. Let's see, can I get the video to come up? All right, so wait, is this it?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. It's a Holder Night 2013 in review.
I think Dad's Christmas Jammies are a little tight, but...
Well, okay, you're about 2 seconds away from that part of the song. The mom's hot, the mom and the dad were both like news anchors, so they're beautiful. They're bragging about their children learning Chinese. You know, they all run triathlons. You know, he was hobnobbing with the governor. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. And you know, they both had a role, cameos in like Iron Man 3 or something as like news reporters. So it's like, boy, did I spend a little time on this video? No, I've only watched it once. But it was well done. It was memorable. The mom's smoking in her Christmas jammies. They, you know, they're outside of her house, and I thought that was well played, if for the bragging douchebag set, because it's like, oh, you could have done this in your basement, but you guys are doing it for the whole neighborhood, and by virtue, showing how awesome your neighborhood is and how awesome your house is. So it just was an elaborate way for them to publicly stroke themselves, and everyone's like, oh, they're so cool, and I'm like, they're such D-bags. I'm so glad I'm not them.
Yeah. I'm not, I don't think their house is all that.
Well, it's nice. Yeah. And then they show the neighborhood. It's like, well, considering that a lot of people live in a place that resembles, you know, Columbus, Ohio.
Right.
It's a pretty damn nice neighborhood they're living in. That's 1%. That's 1%erville they're in, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I see. Now they're putting themselves on TV. I'm getting it. Yeah. I see what you're saying. A little braggadocious triathlon. She was doing a little bicep flex where I almost crapped and threw up on myself when I did the triathlon this year. So.
Well, she did the Ironman too, dude, 70.3 or whatever.
Oh, so. She did the half Ironman. Wow, yeah. Never do that. Yeah, I see the neighborhood now. It's a little, yeah, I see what you're saying. They have it. Seems like it's kind of in a valley. Yeah. Yeah, it's true. Like, if they lived in Justice, they wouldn't be doing it. And obviously, then they show their TV. Yeah, I'm coming to you. Coming over to your side of the aisle, bro.
Yeah, well, you know, and I'm whatever. I don't want to be the one who's like, you know, I'm not jealous or anything, but it's like, okay, then at the end they throw in a couple of weak-ass websites,
yeah.
You know, that, you know, his is like just a blog or whatever. In fact, I'd like to help him with it. He really could have done a few simple upgrades and made it so much better. And then the woman is, you know, apparently has some business that he's joining or whatever, and like half of their site is down. Now, maybe because they probably are, their server's a little bit under duress at the moment, but it's also possible that their website wasn't ready to go. And it's like, see, this wasn't about a business. You guys are just the type of family that sends out that Christmas card letter every year about how incredible you are. And you know what? We hate you. We really do. I hate families that send out that letter, dude.
Yeah, no, I'm not done with those letters either. It's kind of exhausting. But let's see, thegreenroom.com. Let's see what it is.
Yeah, it's just a blah-ass website. And, like, you know, there are several pages that are, like, not working at the moment. And not even, like, her page or his page. It's, like, their employees' pages or whatever. So... part of me smells a rat anyway and thinks that the whole thing was a setup and it was all a promo for the news station that he works at or something or whatever. Who knows? But the larger part of me thinks, no, your name is Penn Holderness, okay? And your son's name is Penn Charles Holderness. And you guys are just douchebags. And every year you guys send out the letter. And this year you decided to up the ante and get Jimmy, the video editor from the news station who you worked with. You paid him $300 and he came over a couple of nights and made a kick-ass video for you.
Yeah.
And this is your version. And for whatever reason, now the whole world is seeing it and you're loving every second of it because your name is Penn Holderness.
Right.
But I'm not buying it, Penn!
No, I can tell, man. I can tell you're passionately not buying it. I kind of see what you're saying with the video. Obviously, now when the TV personalities, and kind of, the house didn't blow me out that much, but the neighborhood, I kind of see what you're saying. The fact that they were their own TV news people, I kind of get maybe they're being a little bit blingy about things.
I would have been much more impressed if it was like Bill, the FedEx driver, and Pam, you know, stay-at-home mom.
Yeah.
And there was no, and it was like legit. Like, yeah, we're just amazingly creative and we made this video and oops, it went viral.
Right.
It would feel so much better. Although I gotta say, Mrs. Holderness, big fan, Miss Holderness.
Yeah, she does. She gets it done. I do have to give her that. There's no doubt about that.
Fab. And her children are under 5.
Yeah.
Not a hint. I'm saying it. She used a surrogate. There, I said it.
Wow. Wow, really? You will stand by that.
And I will probably take in that video at least one more time because of her talents.
in the intense privacy of your own home.
Yes, yes. Her Christmas jammies are worth another view.
Right. No, they certainly are, man. She does keep it together. I'll give her that.
She puts in the work, man.
So okay, well then we determined that you would not do a Noonan family. If you win $60 million, you will not be doing a Noonan family
Christmas video, viral video card thing, bragging.
No, that's out.
Well, you know, I would default to self-deprecation.
Right. Yes, you would. I would like
100 times funnier.
Right. I would probably do that same thing. And I actually, and you and I have spoken about it before, I think we both actually do that to a fault where we really deprecate ourselves.
Yeah, I deprecate my pants constantly. But there are some people I think that are incapable of that quality whatsoever. And I got to think, pen holderness, self-deprecation, not even. That's his version of self-deprecation. I'm in pajamas on my driveway. How much more self-deprecating can I be? It's like, no, you don't understand, dude.
Yeah, yeah. No, I could definitely see that. I could definitely see that. Like, oh, I'm being self-deprecating. I put my $600 loafers on, and I put the left loafer on the right foot. Oh, my God. There's $600. You think they would have told me they're going on the wrong foot, but they didn't. That's cheap for $600 loafers.
You were also in this very large majority of people who do not know the meaning of the word irony, sir.
Yeah. No,
I sound bitter towards Penn, and I'm not. I'm not jealous. I'm not bitter. But I do think it's funny that people fall for these old gags.
Right, right. Although then it's almost like they're prisoners of their own fame. But if their kids are like doing little movies, they're still this family, they do little movies, the parents do like, you know, are newscasters or whatever that is. But then now they're prisoners because the second that they try to break out and do some goofy little video, then it can be construed as, then they're almost sitting there going, oh, to be a pipe fitter, we could do this and get away with it.
Yeah, Oprah was good for one thing, and it's her Where Are They Now retrospective shows. And
right.
I desperately want someone 10 years from now, and maybe I'll be the one to do it. Maybe I'll be the one that does the Where Is Penn Holderness and His Family Now?
Yeah.
This has really been, I really feel like it's been therapeutic. I'm feeling a forward momentum in my life.
Well, I'm glad I could help you with this. I'm sorry that your day got off to a bit of a rough start, but perhaps focusing on what you would do with lottery winnings. I don't know. Maybe that helps both you and I kind of see what we really want, and then we can go after that.
So if you will. You didn't hear a word I said.
No, I will.
Play back.
I would, with my $60 million, focus on my little self-serving podcasting world, and then you would cure people with cancer.
Bullshit. This is bullshit. Just start already. Start.
What do you mean start?
Act as if you have $60 million. I mean, of course, maybe not get the Porsche tomorrow, but could you get a Porsche this year? Yes, you could. Yes,
yeah.
You could, Jones.
I've thought about that. Well, not this year, but maybe next year. This year, I only have about...
No, you got to, like, visualize and verbalize your goals and just make them, manifest them.
All right, well, hey, I will...
That's the problem. You're putting the false construct in your mind. You're blocking your own forward progress by saying, well, I can't have those things because I don't have the $60 million lottery winnings. The whole idea of the lottery is enslavement. It's a diversion from the real problems of the world by the state. The state is diverting our attention with these have you noticed that the lottery numbers have gotten ridiculously higher than ever before? I don't remember $650 million lotteries 5 years ago or 10 years ago. So as the economy and as the state of the world has gone into the toilet bowl, for whatever reason, the lotteries are going through the roof. Why is that?
Right.
Is that a coincidence? How can that be? Our country, our state, our county, our city, we're all broke. But the lotteries, are getting, I mean, they're tickling a billion now. What's going on? Because they're meant to be a diversion. And they're meant to, like, I don't know, like, psychologically fuck with you.
Okay, so if you're me, and now I'm saying, this is what I'd do if I were had $60 million, and you said you don't need $60 million, you need to act as if you have $60 million, what would you tell me or have me do in 14 days away from 2015?
Yeah, so, well, I mean, you just said that, like, okay, we'll take out the Porsche, but you said, oh, I would have, like, a podcasting studio.
Right.
You're like several hundred dollars away from building one of those. So
okay. Okay.
So, that
2014, like, I should build this podcasting studio.
Sure.
Okay. What else would you have me do?
Well, I don't know. You know what else did you say you wanted? That's all you said you wanted. It was a house, a car, and a
A podcast studio. I would like to have my book self-published.
But okay, and you need money to do that?
Yes.
How much?
Well, you have to do, there's like a series of edits and things like that. It's a couple grand. I mean, it's doable. It's kind of my goal that I do that in 2014, that I at least get one of them up and published, and you could go to Amazon and you could buy it in ebook format or in a hard copy format.
Right. And you need to hire an editor?
I need to hire an editor. I need to get some money together and hire an editor. Then I'd have to do, like, kind of a book designer. And
right. So why don't you at least do a Kickstarter and see what, if maybe you could strike lightning and get that.
See, I brought that up to Eileen about the Kickstarter. And she was like, nah. I mean, in her mind, she was kind of, like, concerned it would be, like, begging for money. And I'm kind of like, well, who do you really reach out to on Kickstarter, like, that it would work? I don't know. Like, how do you, other than me asking you and Andy to check out my Kickstarter campaign and give me money to do
this? Do definitely need people to kind of spread it around or whatever and get involved. But, you know, so there's a woman, she's like 30 now, who I funded, you know, like $25 or something like that. But I helped fund her Kickstarter to produce her latest album. So she raised like $9,000, on Kickstarter. And for that investment level, I got like 2 CDs or something. I think she mentioned me in a liner notes anyway, because I've known her for 15 years or whatever. Did she have the built-in advantage of playing a lot of gigs, constantly mentioning it, having friends who spread it around? You know, probably she had about 150 backers, so she got decent support. But you don't know unless you at least throw it up there, Indiegogo or Kickstarter or whatever. Now, like, so I did, like, the financial version of Kickstarter for businesses. So I did Crowdfunder and Fundable and a thing called AngelList. And, like, pretty much if you don't promote it there, no one's going to find it. So it went nowhere, but I figured, fuck it, I gotta at least try. The worst part is not even trying at all. So, I don't know, man. Yeah, is it pandering? Sure, but I mean, you give them incentives to get involved. All right, I'll mention you in the liner, inside liner notes, or whatever you do for a book. You gotta budget out what you need, obviously, because you don't wanna. The worst sin in Kickstarterville would be to promise and then not be able to deliver. Like some band, contributed to a Kickstarter for a band here in Chicago named the Action Blast, who needed help like fixing their tour van. And for that investment level, I was supposed to get a shirt. And they ended up using the money to go on tour in Europe and didn't even like fix the van and never sent me my shirt. They pretty much stole my money. And whenever I sent them a note and been like, hey, man, in Kickstarter land, this is pretty shitty, actually. You should send me a shirt, man. They, like, don't even respond. So, yeah, are there some douchebags out there? Absolutely. But for the most part, most people have it budgeted out. They know if I get $5,000, that's enough to press or print, you know, 500 books or whatever.
Right.
Get edited, get it designed, get it put in, you know, the ebook format and get 500 copies so I can at least fulfill to my backers and at least just put up a page and see if if how many people contribute. You might be surprised, dude. Especially if you have some decent, like, high levels of involvement, like, you know, for $1,000, I come over and I do a book reading at your place or whatever.
Yeah.
You never know. You might get a couple of $1,000 things.
You're right. You're right. I should. That'll be.
You'd have so much fun with it, dude, that, like, you could come up with some really cool incentives. And that's, like, I don't know about Indiegogo because I've never done one of those, but on Kickstarter, that's what it's all based on incentives. I think Indiegogo is like Kickstarter, only you get to keep what you raise as opposed to Kickstarter where you have to beat your goal.
Right, right.
So, but you are a creative dude. You can come up with some cool incentives, and you never know, man. And you know a lot of people now, and especially you know some well enough connected people that you might get some people throwing down $250. $15,000 watch guy might go, you know, Jones is worth 60% of my watch's annual maintenance fee.
When you put it that way, it's now seeming more possible. But, no, you're right. I mean, that really has to be my hard and fast $60 million dream on a $60 budget plan to launch my podcast or a podcast and launch at least one of my books in 2016.
Yeah, I'd be happy to help you so long as you don't call it a podcast. Jesus.
Whatever, show pod something. And then, just if it goes right, and even if I get a little money in my back pocket, even if I just went out and bought like a 1983 Porsche 911, Porsche 944, just for the mentality of I went out and got a Porsche.
Yeah, with my own money.
Yeah.
Basically, the money, I didn't win it, I bought it.
You're right.
Well, that's the thing. Would your sister buy a lottery ticket?
Would my sister buy a lottery ticket?
Is she opposed to that? You know, is she opposed to that on some level?
No.
She's not, but she wouldn't buy one.
I don't know if she did buy one.
That's all I'm saying is, so is it better, you know, so she's anti-Kickstarter, even though you're saying, here, this is how much it's going to cost, this is what I'm going to give you in return. This isn't a handout. I'm going to give you an incentive for contributing. I need your greenbacks. Here's what I'm going to do with it. But this is the cool stuff that you can get in return. Yeah, obviously,
right.
If you make it all lame-o, then, yeah, oh, I'm just going to, you know, send you a copy of the book. I mean, you got to come up with fun things.
Right. You're right. I got to hammer that out. But you're right.
You would probably buy a lottery ticket and talk about a handout. Oh, you pay $2, you get a quick pick, and then the state, mother government gives you $60 million after taxes or whatever, or $500 million or whatever. Kickstarter is way more earning it than a lottery ticket.
No. I mean, I see.
So you sell her to go pound sand. That's what I say.
You're right. The hell with my sister. You're right.
Lose the dead weight in 2014, Jones. The naysayers.
All right. Well, no, you're right. I gotta, in some form or fashion, whether it's $60 million or $60, I got to get
one
out
there. Why don't you put together a Kickstarter for your podcast studio, for God's sakes?
Well,
you don't want to pick messages? Pick the one that's more near and dear to you. There's no reason why you can't have two projects at the same time.
Yeah.
And that one could be super cool where you go like, hey, man, if you bid $1,000, you get to come over and be on the show and drink beer with us or whatever.
Yeah, I like where you're going with that. I'm inspired now. I'm looking forward to 2014.
But I would make it like really like, all right, this is going to be the studio. Like, this is what it's going to look like. This is where it's going to be. These are the, you know, we're going to have this equipment. We're going to have, you know, I've always wanted to have like animation and stuff like mixed in, like Ricky Gervais style. It's going to cost X amount, you know, like really, like, you know, we're going to go and we're going to do it on the road. You get to come with if you're a top contributor, whatever. I mean, just really dream, like, much bigger than a podcast, I'd say.
Right. I got to come over to your place and kind of, you know, map this out. Like, we can sit down and brainstorm and map this out of what it could be.
You know where we live.
I know, and I can see it. I can see it happening now. Where, like, before I talked to you today,
it seemed like it was a possible dream.
And for Impossible Dream, I was waiting on $60 million. Now
yeah,
I'm like,
well, I'm
motivated.
Inspiring.
You're right?
Apparently, I'm not inspiring to sales reps, but
well,
I'm inspiring to someone.
You know, yeah. Just inspiring one person should be motivating, Mike.
Well, get over here before my lung cancer takes me out, or whatever I've got. I started off so healthy an hour ago.
Well,
now
right.
I can't breathe.
Yeah, why can't you breathe?
I don't know. Oh, I knew I was going to do that. I've been fighting it. And I've been like, all right, dude, just choke it back.
Oh, how long were you choking it back? It sounds like 20 minutes.
For a while.
Damn.
So I'm not all the way back, but to think that today was the healthiest I've been in 4 months.
That is not good, my man.
No, I'm almost done. We all have a cough in my house. Dominic, Grace, me.
Yeah.
So, no big deal. Poor Dominic, he hasn't slept in 2 days.
Ugh.
Yeah, it's brutal, dude. It's brutal.
Little guy.
Yeah, he'll make it, though. All right, onward and upward, Jones. This has been
right.
Transformative.
You're right. $60 million dreams are happening, even if it's a $60 actuality in 2014. I'm inspired. You've motivated.
Now, and do yourself a favor. Don't even look at that. Don't even watch the lottery drawing. Not that you would have anyway.
Right.
And never buy a lottery ticket again. They're not selling dreams. They're selling enslavement.
You won me over.
We're in bizarro world. What they say, vitamins are bad for you. Drugs are good for you. I mean, lottery is freedom. It's like Orwell, dude. Orwell envisioned all of this stuff. He said this was all going to happen. I think he was a demon of some sort. I think in 1984, didn't they have some sort of a lottery in 1984? I think that there was some talk of, like, the lottery in that book, dude.
I read the book. I'm trying to remember specific. I know it pretty well. I'm trying to remember if there was a lottery. I think that there was, like, some kind of government incentive dream, you know. I forget what the particulars of it, but I think you're right about that. But in terms of, maybe he was a demon, maybe he was an angel.
Yeah. I think there is something to these ridiculous payouts being kind of manipulated and rigged to keep hope alive. You know, it used to be that you dreamed of just getting up, providing for your family, going to work, getting your pension, retiring, all that stuff. And now that stuff is like impossible. Everyone's living check to check or even at a deficit every week. And so now they're like, all right, well, we'll just have these ridiculous payouts on these lotteries, and these idiots will have hope every, like, 2 months. It seems like it's every 2 months. It's like a ridiculous payout. And everyone, like, gets in line like morons at the Lotto machine at the gas station. And they forget that, oh, you don't have a job that's worth a damn, and you don't have any, you know, and you have college you still have to pay off your $100,000 college loan.
Right, yeah.
With a job that you're underemployed at. Good luck.
And that's kind of
buy your lottery tickets.
That's exactly what I was doing today.
Oh, heavens. You're not one of the sheeple, Jones. You're one of the sheeple herders.
Thank you, Mike.
I'll talk to you later.
All right, man. I'll talk to you later.
See you, buddy. Bye-bye.
sorry, the number you have dialed is not in service at this time.